your newsletter. Turn with me to Matthew chapter 7 here this morning. Last week we dealt with the sycamore tree and how God gives us the answer in scripture, how to keep our heart free from unforgiveness or bitterness or anything else that would try to get into it, the sycamore tree. But here this morning I want to deal with something very close to the same subject but different, on how to judge biblically. How to judge biblically. Matthew chapter 7. Saints, these teachings were taught by Jesus. They are basic teachings. They are elementary and yet rarely taught in the church. I want to teach you here this morning how to teach, how to judge biblically. When we first started this church, I taught 15 messages on how to judge biblically. The reason I done that was because I lived the previous 42 years in churches and conventions under good ministry, and only once in 42 years did I hear a message on how to judge biblically. You can be under the greatest of ministry and yet not have basic things taught to you and you don't learn them. These things are important because Jesus taught them and they're practical in our Christian life. Reading from Matthew chapter 7 verse 1. Judge not that ye be not judged. For with what judgment ye judge, ye shall be judged. And with what measure ye meet, it shall be measured to you again. And why beholdest thou the mote that is in thy brother's eye, but considerest not the beam that is in thine own eye? Or how wilt thou say to thy brother, let me pull out the mote out of thine eye, and behold, the beam is in thine own eye? Thou hypocrite, first cast out the beam out of thine own eye, and then shalt thou see clearly to cast out the mote out of thy brother's eye. Give not that which is holy unto dogs, neither cast ye your pearls before swine, lest they trample them under their feet and turn again and rend you. Let's pray. Father, I pray, Lord God, do teach us, do instruct us this morning. My God, you said, O God, that all of your word is profitable for edification, for exhortation, for rebuke, Lord God, to bring us to a place of maturity and perfection. And Father, I pray, even this morning, bless your word. We know that your word is eternal, and whosoever doeth the word of God shall abide and remain for all eternity. My God, I want to be here when planets have gone. I want to be here and remain in fellowship with you. Lord God, when this old world of ours has been wrapped up and been cast away, my God, I want to obey your word. I want to do your word. I want to live your word, Lord God, in such a way that it'll make me to outlive, Lord God, this old universe of ours. Lord God, I do bless you and praise you, yes, and ask for your blessing on your word this morning. Yes, in Jesus' name. Help us to discern and help us to judge righteous judgment in the name of Jesus. Yes. Amen. Amen. Matthew chapter 7, how to judge biblically. Do you realize all over our world, not only in the church but in society, on the high street, one of the most common statements you hear is that we shouldn't judge. Everybody knows that Jesus taught you should not judge. Every dog on the street knows that if we're Christians and we want to be religious, we should never at all in any way or in any time judge anybody else. We should never judge a person. You see, that is a comment that everybody knows. Don't judge, judge not. Yet I want to tell you that statement, judge not, from Matthew chapter 7 and verse 1, is one of the most dangerous terms that is ever used by anyone in this city or this nation today. I believe the term do not judge me is one of the most abused terms and one of the most dangerous terms. But usually those who use it and say, don't judge, you're not allowed to judge, you can't judge me, Usually they judge you if you judge them. They tell you you cannot judge,
yeah.
But if you make a judgment according to the Bible, they actually begin to judge you. Now, I've seen this for 25 years. I've seen it in the church. People say we're not meant to judge anything. We're not meant to judge how people live.
Yeah.
We're not meant to judge how the church is. We're not meant to say anything. We're not meant to point the finger. So we're not meant to do that. And yet if you make a judgment, they always judge you. Don't you know you're not meant to judge? Don't you know you're not meant to say that things are wrong? So they are making themselves judges. What are they doing? They are doing what they're telling you you cannot do. They judge you when you make judgments. You see, this term judge is not a negative word, but it is a very positive word. And when Jesus says do not judge, he doesn't mean it's a ban on all judgment. He's not saying you can never judge at any time or anybody. He's not saying that, because in John 7:24, Jesus also says judge righteous judgment. That is a command. Jesus actually teaches us you are to judge. And when you judge, it is to be righteous. So we see that Jesus not only says don't judge, he also says judge. So what does it mean? We also see in Matthew 7:6 that Jesus teaches we are to judge or discern dogs and pigs. In verse 15 of this same chapter, down to verse 20, we actually read that Jesus teaches we are to judge false prophets.
Mm.
So here we are, we are to judge pigs, we're to judge dogs,
yeah.
We're to judge false prophets.
Yeah.
And yet, the first verse, Jesus says, judge not. So it cannot mean that we're never to judge. But there is a time when we cannot judge. There is a type of judgment we must not make. There is a judgment that is condemned by Jesus. And Jesus said, if you judge like this, you will be condemned. But yet judgment is not wrong.
Right.
All judgment is not wrong. Judging people is not wrong. In fact, I want to exhort you right now as I begin to preach. I want you to judge me.
Yeah.
I want you to judge my preaching.
Yeah.
I want you to listen in such a way that you're judging the words that I say. See, that is a good thing. It is an important thing that we do that, even in church. So judging is not a negative word. The command given by Jesus has a context, and we want to look at that context for a moment. The word judge here is the Greek word krino. Krino. And I want to give you a definition of what it means to judge. What does it mean to judge? Because sometimes you're not meant to judge. And sometimes you have to judge or you will get yourself in trouble. Have you ever seen a mother going shopping? And she's down in one of these shopping centers of our city. And she goes to the apple section and she lifts up apples. What is she doing? Does she just put whatever apples into the basket? She says, I'll turn away my eyes and just put the apples in. After all, I have to trust the shop. I have to trust that all the apples are the same. She actually looks with her eyes. Then there's some things to her groceries she picks up and she begins to balance in them and look at them and say, are they ripe? Are they off? Are they damaged? Are there bruises to them? So a mother is making a judgment. That is judgment.
Right.
You cannot drive a car without judging.
Right.
You come to a stop sign. You look left, you look right. You look either way, there's a car coming, you make a judgment. Is it going fast enough to let me out? Or is it too fast and I would be in an accident if I pull out? What do I do? Do you realize when you walk down the road, you make judgments all the time?
Yeah.
You can't go through one day without making a judgment.
Yeah.
What does the word judge mean? There's three definitions I want to give you here. The word, the Greek word judge, to judge actually means to scrutinize, to look at, to investigate, to interrogate, or determine by asking questions, discerning with the eye, or to walk in around it, looking at it. You have to actually look at facts or look at evidence. Some people say you can't look. Don't look. Close your eyes. Act blind and just love everybody. That is not Christianity. Yeah. Jesus never taught that. He says you must judge, but be careful how you judge. When you judge, you need to investigate. You ought to ask questions. You ought to discern with your eye. But it also means to weigh. Look what I'm doing with my hands. I am weighing things. You're meant to gather these facts. Get evidence. Then you weigh this evidence. You compare it. You evaluate it. You look at it side by side. And then thirdly, there's a third part of this. You come to a decision. You come to a conclusion. You make a decision about what you've looked at, what you've weighed. You now make a decision what you're going to do with that. Yeah. Now, saints, all through the Bible, this is what judge means. And if you never judge, if you never look with your eyes, you're going to get in very serious trouble. So tell me, why did Jesus say in verse 1, judge not? Why did he say that with all that I'm saying? Why did Jesus say, do not judge? What does that mean if elsewhere he tells us we are to judge? Well, it has a context. I've got three points for you here this morning. And my first point is wrong judgment.
Yeah.
This is judgment that you're not to make. You cannot make. And you will be guilty of sin if you do make. You see, the context of Jesus' words is wrong judgment. Look at verse 5 with me for a second. It says, thou hypocrite. Who's he saying? You cannot judge. You must not judge. He's speaking to a particular person with a particular condition of heart. He's not saying it to all Christians. He's not saying it to everybody in the world. He's speaking to a particular kind of person. And in verse 5, we see who it is. He's saying, you hypocrites must not judge. If either in your own heart you've come to a condition where at this time you're acting like a hypocrite, you must not judge anybody else. It's dangerous. Yeah. If you're a hypocrite and you judge others, you're in danger of hellfire.
Amen.
It is so, so dangerous. You see, Jesus begins by teaching about hypocritical judgment. Verse 1 to verse 5 is about hypocritical judgment. Judgment that is wrong. Those who shouldn't make judgment. A time when you must not make judgment. What does the word hypocrite mean? It means to be an actor. To not be real. Not be honest. To put on a pretense. To put on a mask. That's how Jesus is speaking to you. He says, you hypocrites must not judge others. Look at verse 3 and 4. It says, and why beholdest thou the mote that is in thy brother's eye, but considerest not the beam that is in thine own eye? Or how wilt thou say to thy brother, let me pull out the mote of thine eye, and behold, a beam is in thine eye. Look at verse 3. A mote is a little bit of straw. Here in these verses, Jesus gives us an example. He's teaching about hypocrites. He's saying, you cannot judge, you must not judge. This is the teaching of Jesus. Why does Jesus teach so we'll learn? If we never learn this, it'll affect our lives. If you don't understand what I'm saying, it's going to affect everything you do in your life. But if you do understand what I'm saying, it will affect your life in a good way.
Yeah.
Here Jesus is saying, there are two men. One of the men has a mote in his eye, the other has a beam in his eye.
Yeah.
Now look at these two men who Jesus showed unto us. The first man has a mote. What was a mote? A mote was a little bit of straw. And if ever you grew up on a farm where they had bales and straw, and I did, You grew up in that farm and you're in there and see when the wind blows in the summer and there's heat in there. A very little tiny bit of straw. It's not a bit of wood. It's a tiny little bit of straw. Really, it's grass that has been harvested. And that little bit of straw, that little bit of hay, actually gets in the eye. And if ever you get straw in your eye, it's worse than anything. I haven't been around farms for many years, and I've never had a problem with my eyes for many years. But if you get in that atmosphere, there's a lot of straw blows about, and it gets in the eye. But Jesus speaks about another man here. He said there's another man, and he's got a beam in his eye. What's a beam? This word being used here was the main big bit of wood to hold up an entire roof of a house.
Yeah.
So look at these two men. Jesus has given us a story, a parable. He's trying to teach us about judgment and hypocrisy. And he said, there's two men. There's a man with a little tiny bit of straw, and it's very hard to see it in the eye. And there's another man who's got a big, massive wooden beam in his eye. Can you see these two men for a minute? And these two men are brothers. They're in the same church. They have fellowship together. They know each other. And they talk together during the week. So Jesus, and believe me, Jesus was the greatest teacher who ever existed. Yeah. And this is what he's teaching us. Here are two men, and both of them have an issue with their eye. Both of them have a problem with their eye. Both of them need something taken out of their eye. Both of them do. But both of them are radically different. Now the man with the large beam in his eye, the Bible actually says in verse 3, he is not considering his own condition. It means to exercise his mind. Now look at the man with the big large wooden beam in his eye. And Jesus is saying, this man with the big beam in his eye, he's not considering himself. He's not using his brain. He's not thinking about his own condition. He is not observing carefully. He is not stopping and perceiving his condition. He actually is blind to his own condition of his own heart. He is trying to deal with something very small in his brother's eye. Now look at these two men. The man with the beam goes to the man with a little bit of straw and he says, let me help you get that little bit of straw out of your eye. Now let me give you a bit of advice here, and it's the counsel of Jesus to you today. If a man with a big beam comes to you and you've got a little bit of dirt in your eye, don't let him help you.
Amen.
Take it out of your eye.
Yeah.
Do not look to him. Saints, what am I telling you? Somebody whose life isn't right.
Yeah.
Somebody who's disobeying the word of God. Somebody who doesn't even try to obey the word of God. Somebody who has many problems in their life. Don't let them try to help you with your Christian life.
Amen.
If you listen to them, say, oh, but they speak so nicely. They smile so smoothly. They embrace me. They shake my hand. Yes. Like Absalom.
Yeah.
You'll find that that man is an Absalom. You may enjoy his handshake, his smile, his nice words, but he is an Absalom. If he has a large beam in his eye, if he doesn't deal with issues in his own life, I assure you that man is dangerous if he tries to help you in your spiritual condition.
Yeah.
Do you remember what Absalom done? He stood at the gate and all the people who came with problems, and they were wanted to go and speak to the king and get the king's judgment on their problems. And yet Absalom stopped them and said, hey, I will help you. Saints, Absalom is the man with the big beam in his eye. And he's trying to stop you going to the king for righteous judgment.
Right.
You see, Absalom had major problems with rebellion, of jealousy, of anger, of hatred. And here he is at the gate, and everybody who came with a problem, he says, hi chum, how are you? Mm-hmm. And he'd take them by the hand, and he'd give them a warm hug and say, hey brother, I'm praying for you. Mm-hmm. Wish you'd pray for yourself. We should pray and repent about your sin and your rebellion against God's word.
Amen.
I get worried about men hanging about gates.
Yes.
And wanting to hear everybody's problem.
Yes.
You see, Jesus is talking about these two men. One man with a small problem, one man with a big. But the man with the big problem, or the big beam in his eye, was trying to deal with the other man. He says, let me help you. Tell me your little problem. I actually have an answer. Listen to my advice. Listen to my counsel. And I'll tell you what you ought to do. Can I tell you, if you listen to that man, you're very foolish. You're like a man with a little bit in your eye. And you're listening to this man with a big beam in his eye. And you don't even look at that big beam. And you're saying, okay, help me.
Yeah.
Do you know what? You're going to lose your head.
Yeah.
Because as soon as he swings around to look, you are finito, R.I.P., rest in peace. I am telling you what happens all the time in the church, and yet this is a very basic teaching in the Bible. Jesus taught this. Why? Because it's for your good, your blessing, your encouragement,
right,
and your protection.
Right.
You see, someone with a beam in their eye is in no condition to judge others or to help others. Do you realize to get something out of someone's eye, you've got to judge. You've got to look. You've got to see something in your brother's eye. You've got to investigate it. You've got to weigh up the facts and say, now how am I going to get it out of there? And are you willing for me to get it out of there? And then you've got to make a decision and you've got to act. But notice how Jesus says, don't let that man help you, no matter how bad your condition is. Do not listen to his advice. He is more concerned about the failures of others than his own failures.
Yeah.
He has a sense of urgency,
yeah,
saying, I want to help you. I can help you with your problem. Let's talk about your problem. How about talking about your problem? He is driven with a sense of urgency. He actually thinks your problem is more serious than his problem.
Yeah.
He thinks dealing with you is more important than actually dealing with himself. He has got no thought about dealing with his own sin. He can say, look, you've got this in your life. But he ignores the massive sin in his own life. And Jesus shows that here in these verses. His own condition of having something in his eyes, something big, obscured his vision, and he couldn't see his own condition. But, listen this, it heightened his ability to actually see wrong in others. His condition blinded him to his own sin, but it made him very able to see little tiny sins in the lives of others. Now, since we deal with this all of the time, every single year, for 25 years, I have dealt with this in the church, where I have constantly seen people who want to come and judge little things.
Yeah. Yes.
But when I look at their life, they've got massive beams, yeah, in their life, yeah, and they can't even see it.
Amen.
And they said, but look at this.
Yeah.
But they cannot see their own beam.
Yeah.
Those people are extremely dangerous in the church and the body of Christ. They are actually blind. They're blind people trying to help someone else who's only a little dimmed in their vision. This man has now become a danger to the church, a danger to other Christians. He isn't helping anybody. The word brother, means born from the same womb. It's used three times in these verses. It's talking about two Christians.
Yeah.
Yes.
The hypocrite isn't a sinner.
Mm-hmm.
He isn't outside the church. He's in the church. But he is a brother. Hear me. He's a hypocrite, but he is a brother.
Yeah.
He is a real, genuine Christian. But he's got a problem that he is not dealing with. There's one of these brothers. He does want help. He does recognize his condition. He does understand he needs someone to help him. But the other one has massive problems, but he doesn't see his need and he's not looking for help. He's looking to minister to others when he needs ministry himself.
Right.
And this is what you often see is people with beams, they want to minister. They're not conscious of receiving ministry. They want to minister to everybody else. But they're not qualified to do that. In these verses, it's talking about brothers, not sinners. It's not talking about wolves. It's not talking about goats. It's talking about two sheep who are brothers. Can a genuine believer fall into hypocrisy? Can someone who's really been born again or met with the Lord for a time or because of a situation become hypocritical in their words or their actions? Yes. Anybody could play the hypocrite. Anybody. And we need to be careful. You may say, I find that hard to believe that a genuine believer could fall into hypocrisy. Let me prove it. It's not what I meant to do. If I make a statement, I can prove it to you from the Bible. Who was one of the greatest men, the greatest man in the Old Testament? Was it not King David? Listen to the story in 2 Samuel chapter 12. David previously had fallen into sin. He had slain Goliath. He had ran from Saul. He had trained the greatest army in the face of the planet. He had pursued after God. He loved God with all his heart. But for a very brief time, maybe 1 year, maybe two, King David actually committed adultery, fell into sin, had the husband killed. And for a short period of time, he was still worshipping in the house of God. He still sang the songs. He still played his harp. He still was faithful in the house of God. He still said prayers. He didn't pray, he said prayers. Right. He still read the Word of God. He still thought about the Word of God. He spoke about the Word of God. He may have preached the Word of God. He'd done all of these things. He is a remarkable man, but he's in a condition of adultery. He sinned against God, and nobody knows. So he thinks apart from God. Well, here he carries on. What's he doing? It's hypocrisy. Right. He has sinned against God, but he is not honest. He's not open. He's not real. This is serious. Adultery is serious. Murder, or should I say in the New Testament, anger towards a brother is serious. No Christian should be angry with his brother. Right. I don't care what they've done. You never have a right. And if you ever meet a Christian who says, I hate or I am angry, you better get worried about them. Right. That should never dominate the heart of a genuine Christian. But look at David sitting in his palace one day. He is an adulterer in heart. He is playing the hypocrite. Nobody has caught him out. He's the king of Israel. He has served God. He's got a great testimony. He can worship like nobody else in the house of God. Nobody can worship like him. But in his heart, he's an adulterer.
Yeah.
2 Samuel 12. We are actually told about another parable. Nathan came unto David with a parable about two men in a city. Again, two men, like what Jesus told us. These two men lived in the same city at the same time, but they're radically different. One was rich, one was poor. And this rich man had so many sheep, he couldn't even count them. They were innumerable. They were beyond counting. He maybe had tens and tens of thousands of sheep. But there was another man, and he was different. He was a poor man. He only had one sheep. And you know what? That sheep, it had grown up in his home. It was like a daughter to him. I mean, it was like a part of his family. This little sheep was so close to him. He only had this one little sheep. And in this parable, remember, this is Nathan speaking to David. He's preaching. He's a prophet. He's a preacher. And he said, David, listen to this. And he said, one day a traveler came to visit the rich man. And he traveled many miles and he came to the rich man's house. And you know what the rich man done? The rich man didn't want to use one of his sheep.
Yeah.
So he sent someone over and took the one little sheep from the poor man. Now look what's happening. The rich man doesn't want to use all of his sheep. So he steals this one little sheep. And he kills that sheep and he makes a great feast for his friend. Do you know what the Bible says that David's response to that was, listen, David's anger was greatly kindled. Look at David on the throne. Can you see him? He's going, show me this rich man. Where is he? He said, this man will die for his crime. Yeah. If you stole that little lamb, that man ought to die. And you know what? He should give back four times as many as he stole. David is sitting on his throne. He is angry with this man. Notice, he's angry with this man who stole the sheep. He is shaking. He's saying, I'll take my sword myself and do it if nobody else will do it.
Yeah.
Do you know what Nathan the preacher, the prophet, said? He said, David, thou art the man. This is what Jesus is talking about. See, David was a hypocrite. Here he is. He is the man. He gets angry about the man in the story and says, that is so wrong. But that's you.
Yeah.
That's what you're doing. That's how you think. That's how you operate in the church. This is how you treat other people. You are the person. Do you realize that's what wrong judgment is like? It is so dangerous. Wrong judgment is like David sitting angry on the throne saying, I'm very righteous. No, you're a hypocrite. Thank God David repented before God and he says, I'm guilty. May God forgive me. And he was restored again. But it took someone to come what with the word of God and say, thou art the man. Can you imagine if Nathan hadn't have come with that rebuke and that word exposing David and saying, David, it's you. Do you think Nathan hated David? No, he loved him. Nathan loved him enough to tell him the truth.
Yeah.
To expose his heart. To say, you need to get right with God.
Yeah.
This is sin. You don't think it's sin, but it's sin. And you know how I know David was a real man of God? He repented.
Amen.
See, if he'd rejected that, he would have died and gone to hell. Didn't matter what happened previously. Doesn't matter about killing Goliath. He would have died and gone to hell. If he would have said, I don't need to listen to you, Nathan. Nathan, you're wrong. My conscience is fine. I don't know what you're talking about. Oh, yes, you do. You know exactly what I'm talking about, David. Thank God he heard the word of rebuke. Now look what Jesus says, verse 1 and verse 2 again. Judge not that ye be not judged.
Yeah.
For with what judgment ye judge, ye shall be judged. And with what measure ye mete, it shall be measured to you again. What's he saying here? Hypocritical judgment is like a boomerang. You ever seen a boomerang? Those V-shaped sticks they throw around in Australia. Mm-hmm. And you take a boomerang, and what happens with a boomerang? What's the character of a boomerang? You throw it, doesn't matter how hard you throw it, you can throw it as far as you want. You can have the strongest arms. But with this, it's going to come back and hit you. That's what a boomerang does. You can throw it in any direction with all your might. It is going to come back and hit you on the back of the head. And that's what hypocritical judgment is like. If you judge others and your heart is hypocritical, it's coming back to you. If you stop yourself from judging others wrongly, it'll be easier for you in the day of judgment. Jesus is saying here, how you judge others is how I'm going to judge you. Both in this lifetime and in the judgment to come. Hear me. Every hypocrite in the church who judges others but doesn't judge their own life or judges others wrongly,
right,
you are going to get judged in the very same way. How do you want judged? With mercy? You better give that to others. With love? Do you wait for the facts before you make a judgment? Do you judge when you don't have evidence? Do you judge when you weren't there on something and you haven't even spoken to someone who has evidence? Be very careful how you judge. There is a day when we shall be judged by God. On that day, our standard of judgment, which God will judge us with, will be the same of how we have judged others. Christians often plead When it comes to their faults, oh, I didn't see it.
Yeah.
I don't notice it. They're very quick to judge Christians. They can see small things in the eyes of others, but when it's their life, they say, oh, I don't see it like that. I don't see my problem. I think my heart is right. And yet they can see small things in other people's eyes. The Bible says that person is storing up judgment for their own selves. That is how God is going to judge them. God is going to judge them without mercy. God is going to judge them harshly. God is going to judge them extremely.
Yeah.
Because that's what they've done to other Christians. Look at these people, yet their ability to judge others is very heightened. If you have the ability to judge others, then you can judge your own heart.
Right.
Do you hear me? If you've got the ability to look at a brother and sister and say, they are wrong, then you have all the same ability to judge yourself.
Yeah,
and if you do not judge yourself harshly, you judge others harshly, you judge yourself softly. Oh God, give me mercy, have mercy on me. God, call fire down on them.
Yeah.
That's hypocrisy.
Amen.
And Jesus says, that person is heading for judgment. You cannot carry on like that. But let me take you to the second point. The first is hypocritical judgment. The second point is, after we judge ourselves, we can help our brother. We are able to judge our brother. We are allowed to judge our brother, but only after we judge ourselves. Look at verse 5. Thou hypocrite, first cast out the beam out of thine own eye, and then thou shalt see clearly to cast out the mote out of thy brother's eye. Judgment is not condemned in these verses, only for the hypocrite. Only under certain circumstances. Only if his heart is hardened in hypocrisy. But notice Jesus says, hypocrite, listen to me for a minute. You, the hypocrite, can suddenly become someone who can judge others and can help others and can deal with problems in others' life. You can become that sort of person.
Yeah.
That shows that he is a real Christian, a real believer. Because Jesus didn't say, you're out. You hypocrite, there's no hope for you, no chance. Maybe you'll just get saved. Maybe. He's actually saying, no, if you deal with this issue, this beam in your eye, just deal with the beam, suddenly you'll become a person. He says, first cast out the beam out of thine own eye, then thou shalt see clearly.
Mm-hmm.
While you have a beam, you can't see clearly to help anyone else. The first thing you do to become qualified in judging others, and since I am going to judge you, as a brother I am, but more so as a preacher I am.
Amen.
It's not because I hate you, it's because I want to help you.
Amen.
If I see someone drinking, I don't condemn them and say, I'm not touching you. I actually want to help you.
Amen.
If I see you struggling with sin, I want to help you.
Amen.
I'm not trying to destroy you, or make you ashamed, or expose you, or trip you up, or put you out the door. I'm not trying to do that.
Amen.
As a preacher of the gospel, I am qualified, I am called, I am commanded to judge. You know, my job is to look after the sheep. And do you realize, Candace's dad, I've told you this before. He worked on a farm in South Africa. They had many animals. But it started to become too much of a burden. Which animal did they get rid of first? The sheep.
Yeah.
Get rid of all the sheep. Why? There's more problems with sheep than any other animal on the face of the earth. And you know, when Jesus talks about the Christian, he says, you're sheep. That's what I call you. Sheep, there's a lot of problems with sheep. And you know, that's why God puts a shepherd over sheep. Because I have to check your feet.
Yeah,
you know, you do that with sheep. You actually turn them up, take a good look at those feet. Because if foot rot sets into those feet, it's finished. We'll have to kill it. Its life will be over. So that shepherd does look after the sheep, not because he hates them, because he loves them. He's caring for the flock. It's a normal part of it. It is not wrong to cast out the mote out of thy brother's eye. It's not wrong to see something in your brother's eye. That's not wrong. It's not wrong to say, can I help you get something out of your eye? No, I'm fine. No, you're not fine. Your eye's watering. You can't even see. Yeah. Can I help you? No, I'll be fine. I'll just let it work its way out. Why not let me help you?
Yeah.
Now, saints, an eye is a delicate thing. Be careful who goes near your eye.
Yeah. Yeah.
Be careful who tries to get something out of your eye.
Yeah.
I don't want a blind man doing it. Can you imagine a blind man trying to get something out of my eye?
Yeah.
And yet all the time we have Christians in our churches, we sit there and listen to blind men.
Yeah.
Wow.
Blind men who don't know the Word of God.
Yeah.
They don't obey the Word of God. They're not practicing the Word of God. They don't even see the problems in their own life. But they want to minister to you. Oh, I think you should do this.
Yeah.
Oh, I can remember a vision. Oh, I've got a prophecy from the Lord. Oh, I had this experience. That is a blind man trying to help you. Don't let them near your eye. The eye is a very delicate. Once that eye's damaged, it's damaged.
Yeah.
It's such a delicate and a Gentile thing. When we deal with ourselves, we are actually brought to a place where we can rightly discern and judge and help our brother with things that are wrong in his own life. Surely we're meant to do that as brothers and sisters in the church. But thirdly, let me bring you to the last verse of these verses, these six verses. And my third point, we must judge dogs and pigs. We must judge dogs and pigs. So we see that Jesus calls people in the church. Sometimes he calls them sheep. Other times he calls them goats. Sometimes he calls men in the church wolves.
Yeah.
And the odd time we'll have people called foxes.
Yeah.
But look here, here Jesus is saying about dogs and pigs. Read it in verse 6. Give not that which is holy unto the dogs. Neither cast ye your pearls before swine. Why? Lest they trample them under their feet and turn again and they rend you. We must not treat dogs and pigs like sheep. Now hear me. If you're a farmer, you don't feed a pig the same as a sheep. Do you realize pigs eat anything? Sheep don't.
Yeah.
You've got to lead sheep into new green pastures. You've got to keep moving sheep to a fresh pasture that they can eat and satisfy. A pig, you get all of your worst waste from your house.
Yeah.
I don't care whether it's edible or not. They will eat anything and everything. You know, Brother Will Graham, who came here and preached on Facebook, he put up a video. And he was at a man's farm, and he was pouring out a bucket and feeding the pigs. I said, Brother, I never thought I'd see the day when Will Graham would be happily feeding pigs. Never thought it. You don't feed sheep the way you feed pigs.
Yeah.
You feed them radically different. They're two different animals.
Yeah.
But look at Jesus. He actually talks about dogs and swine, or the swine or pigs. They represent people in the church, in the church. Not talking about the Catholic Church. Not talking about atheists or sinners in your family. It's talking about people who mix with Jesus, who knew the gospel. And it says here, you must judge or discern if someone is a dog or pig. Jesus says, don't give dogs that which is holy. Don't give pearls to the swine. So Jesus is saying, you're going to have to make a decision. You're going to have to make a judgment. You're going to have to come to a conclusion and say, is this person in the church a sheep, a dog, a pig, or are they a wolf? Or maybe they're a goat. Saints, people in the church are all these different animals,
yeah.
But only sheep are born again.
Yeah.
The rest aren't. They're going to hell.
Right.
Goats are on their way to hell.
Yeah.
Wolves are on their way to hell.
Yeah. Amen.
Dogs and pigs are on their way to hell.
Yeah.
This is what Jesus actually teaches here. And he says you can't treat pigs and dogs like sheep. You must treat them actually differently. Well, who are these dogs? Who are these pigs? Listen to what it says in 2 Peter chapter 2 and 22. Peter also talks about dogs and pigs in the church. He says, but it happened unto them according to the true proverb. He's quoting from Proverbs in the Old Testament. And he says, the dog is turned to his own vomit again. You know, our little puppy last night, she was out with us and she vomited 3 times. First thing I do is grab her, because I know what the Bible says. A dog vomits, it turns to its vomit. That's its nature, it eats it again. The thing that made it sick, it actually wants to eat it immediately. So what do? I grab puppy Shiloh as soon as she vomits and go, you're not going to be eating your vomit. I know it's within your nature, but I'm going to help you. I'm going to bring some good judgment into your life. But look what Peter says. He says the dog has turned to his own vomit again. And the sow that was washed to her wallowing in the mire. So we see Jesus and Peter talking about pigs and dogs and their people in the church. They're not right with God. They're not walking with God. But they can look like other Christians. So how do we distinguish them? Notice the dogs. They vomit. You see, a dog can feed on things that are going to make it sick. Mm-hmm. It eats something that it ought not to eat. It's talking about wrong teachings. Dogs feed on wrong teachings. They can't discern between the food of a sheep and the food of a dog. They cannot discern. And what does a dog do? A dog will actually eat things that make it sick. Do you know what our puppy ate last night? It was a bit of those foam things that you clean your dishes with. Do you know, doggies aren't meant to, that's not meant to go in the stomach. It's not food, but our puppy wants to eat it. And a bit later I found the rest of it. She grabbed it. I had to fight her for it. Any other time say, give me it, she'll give me. But she ain't letting go of that. She says, I'm going to eat this. Puppy, you don't know what's good for you. I'm not letting go. So many Christians are like that.
Yeah.
There are people in the church who literally feed on food that's destroying them, that makes them violently sick. Jesus says there are dogs in the church. They feed on false doctrine that will destroy them and send them to hell. Do you realize the prosperity gospel will send you to hell? Peter taught that. Paul taught that. Yeah. Those men who preach for money and make merchandise out of you, they're always begging for money. I want to tell you, I don't care how big their church is, they're on their way to hell. Be very careful who you listen to.
Yeah.
If you're sitting there listening to a dog in the pulpit, you'll get very sick. You'll get confused in your teaching. You're not going to be a healthy sheep, I assure you. Look at these dogs. They represent preachers and Christians in the church who mix truth with error. And they can't tell the difference. And if you try to give them something holy, they say, what's that?
Yeah.
If you try to give them something holy, they'll actually turn on you and attack you. And he's not talking about puppy dogs in this. Mm. He's not talking about little house pets. You know the dogs in ancient Israel, they were violent animals. They would rove in packs around the streets of little towns. They would attack you. They were violent animals. They weren't little puppies. They weren't pets. They were violent animals. If you interfere with them, with their feeding, and this is the test of a dog, how you know a dog in the church. If you interfere in its feeding, it will turn on you and attack you.
Yeah.
You're trying to help it, it will attack you and it will rend you. Jesus said it.
Yeah.
What about pigs? What is a pig or a sow? Peter says that they get all nicely washed up, then they go back to the world. They actually roll in the world. But notice they're Christians. They don't want rebuked. They don't want corrected. They don't admit their sin. They say, I'm fine. No, you're getting drunk. There's nothing wrong with that. I take the odd glass. Maybe 5 or 10.
Yeah.
But what's up to you? I'm as good a Christian as you. No, the Bible says that no drunkard will enter the kingdom of heaven. You cannot do that. So Jesus is talking about, Peter is talking about the pigs or the sow. They love to wallow in The mud, you can bring it in, dress it up, put a pink ribbon in its head. It'll smell beautiful, it looks beautiful, and as soon as you open that door, it immediately runs for the mire, yeah. And it rolls in the muck, and it goes, now this is how I like to live.
Yeah.
And it says, if you offer pearls, now notice the judgment, you are to make a judgment who is a dog and a pig, because you're not to give what's holy to dogs.
Yeah.
And you're not to give pearls to pigs.
Yeah.
It's not just saying you've got to identify them. Don't give pearls to pigs. Why? They say, I don't see any cost in them.
Yeah.
And you know what Jesus said? It says, how you know a pig is when you try to give it pearls, it'll get mad at you because it'll say, I thought it was pig food. Why are you giving me pearls? And it'll turn and try and rend you. What are the holy things? The word means sacred. It means things that are set apart to be used for a set purpose. One of the pearls, they are precious things. You know how pearls are created? Through great pain over many years. Pearls are very costly, hard to find. So these holy things and pearls, do you know what I believe they are? I believe the holy things and the pearls, they are rebuking one another as brothers and sisters. This is the teaching of go to your brother if you see him sin. Yeah. It's about correction or rebuking your brother or pointing out your brother's sin or judging your brother's life. That's the teaching here. And it's saying don't give what's holy to the dogs or pearls to pigs. Why? Because they'll look at these things, they'll get angry at you.
Yeah.
And listen to what it says here. It actually says they shall turn again. The dog and the pig, when you try to bring correction, when you try to bring the word of God, when you try to show them what Jesus taught and the apostles taught, do you know their reaction? This is how you identify them. They turn on you. They actually twist. They change direction.
Yeah.
They turn around. They're no longer after the holy things of the pearls. They turn back on you. And notice what Jesus says, and they will rend you. That means cut you, break you, lacerate you. Do you want to identify a dog? Just try to apply God's word. Brother, do you know what the word of God says? And you watch the reaction.
Yeah.
Or with a pig. Brother, do you know that going back to the world, do you know you'll damn your soul? Who do you think you are?
Yeah, amen.
I'm telling you how to identify dogs and pigs. Jesus said, don't give them pearls. Don't give them holy things. What does it mean? What does it actually mean? Do you know what it says in Proverbs chapter 9? He that reproveth a scorner getteth to himself shame. In other words, don't reprove. You know the Bible says reprove your brother.
Yeah.
Reprove your sister. Reprove your friend. If they're in sin, reprove them. Show them their sin. But look at Proverbs 9. It says, don't do that to everyone.
Yeah.
Don't do that to anyone. Be very careful who you reprove or you start using your biblical judgment with. Or start saying, brother, we want to do things biblically. The Bible says, if you sin against me, I come to you. I haven't talked to anyone else. I'm coming to you and I want to restore your friendship. And I just want to talk face to face. Who do you think you are? Oh, I don't know what you're talking about. You know what you're dealing with? A pig and a dog. The Bible says you can easily mistake a dog and a pig for a sheep. And in the church you could think they're all the same. No, they're all sheep. No, they're not.
Yeah.
When have you ever seen a sheep attacking a shepherd?
Yeah.
Have you ever seen it?
No.
Have you ever? And remember, the pig isn't just the nice porky pig that you see. Do you know what those pigs were? Were wild boars.
Yeah.
Candace's father again, he carried a scar, I believe, on his leg. Right up his leg, his thigh. From a wild boar, a wild pig that rent him. And from the day it happened, he carried that wound until the day he died. It marked him for the rest of his life. And I want to show you, I've met a few wild pigs in my time. And I've met a few wild dogs. And to the dogs, I brought holy things and said, "Here, boy, here, boy." He said, "I don't want that stuff." And he turned and tried to rend me and attack me. And the pig come running. I had a whole pile of pearls for them. And I said, "Here, boy, here, boy." And the pig come all happy. And when he got to me and said, "What? What are these?" He had no value on the pearls. He said, "Give me pig food."
Yeah.
"What do you mean pig food? Do you know all the trash? All the rubbish."
Yeah.
"A bless me gospel. A gospel that says you can live like the world and still get to heaven. You know, give me pig food." And you know what? Those pigs have hated me because I try to feed them like a sheep.
Yeah.
And the dogs try to maul me because I'm trying to feed them like sheep. "Here, Skippy. Here, Skippy." I'm telling you, I've been a farmer in my days. You know, Candace always wanted to marry a farmer when she married me as a preacher. Well, now our mum says, "Well, you got your wish. You've married a farmer, a sheep farmer."
Yeah.
But not only a sheep farmer, you're going to have to deal with dogs.
Yeah.
And with pigs. Uh-huh. And with goats. And with wolves.
Uh-huh.
Since it's all here in these verses. The Bible says, "Do not reprove a scorner. Reprove not a scorner, lest he hate you." How do you know a scorner? How do you know a pig and a dog? They will hate you when you try to minister God's word. But it says, "Rebuke a wise man and he will love you." Do you know a real sheep, how you know them? You bring a correction and they go, "I'm so glad for protection. I am so glad you care for me."
Yes, sir.
Do you know how you tell a pig and a dog? They say, "You hate me and I hate you. I'm a shepherd. You're trying to make me into a pig farmer. I'm not a pig farmer, saints.
Yeah.
I'm not a dog breeder. I'm here to raise up sheep to maturity." And since Jesus says, "Give not that which is holy to the dogs, neither cast ye your pearls before swine, lest they trample them underfoot." We don't care about the truth. If you ever meet a Christian and they say, "I don't care what the Bible says," or you try to minister the truth and they trample it underfoot and they go, "Pearls, what are they?"
Yeah.
I actually think, I know you do. I believe we should be like this as a church. I know you do.
Mm-hmm.
Why do you think I've spent my entire life preparing to stand in a pulpit, and yet we get people come in the door, they don't even read their Bible.
Yeah.
They don't even know the scriptures. They don't even know Matthew 7 is in here.
That's
they
right.
Don't even understand what it means.
That's
and you know what? They start trying to give a lecture and say, I think.
Right.
I think we should love the pigs and the dogs like the sheep. I think we should feed them all the same. I think you should be running after the pigs, the dogs.
Yeah.
Saints, I'd be worn out.
Amen.
I am here for the sheep, but this same ability to judge, you not only discern dogs and sheep, and let me finish with this. Thank God in the New Testament, the dogs and the pigs are not sinners. It's not talking about your unsafe family. It's not talking about the drug seller on the high street.
Yeah.
It's not talking about the woman in the red light district of this city. It's not talking about them. Do you know, the Bible talks about those who are sinners as sheep as well. Lost sheep.
Yeah.
Straying sheep. Do you know in Isaiah 53, who did Jesus die for? Sheep that were lost in their sin.
Yeah.
And don't ever think just because someone is a sinner that they're a goat. They're not.
Right.
Goats are people in the church who think they're Christians and they're not.
Yeah.
Right.
Aren't you glad that Jesus, and telling the story about the prodigal son, there was a way back for the prodigal son. We need to make a difference between people in the church who say, "There's nothing wrong in my life. There's no sin in my life. I know Jesus like you. And I don't like the teaching of God's word." That's someone who's a dog and a pig. But since the prodigal son who took all of his inheritance went into another land, he was not a dog, neither was he a pig.
Yeah.
He was a lost sheep.
Amen.
What about the man with the legion of demons who cut himself and lived in a graveyard? He was not a pig or a dog.
Yeah.
He was a sheep on its way to hell that needed born again, and Jesus went there to him. Or what about Mary Magdalene with her seven demons? Did Jesus not go looking for them? Are the tax collectors like Zacchaeus in Damascus or Levi in Capernaum? Didn't Jesus go and sit with the tax collectors? These are the worst sinners. He wasn't saying you're pigs or your dogs. Do you know who he said that to? The religious. He said it to the Pharisee. He said it to those who are nice, clean, and respectable in the house of God, who believed the Bible and said, we're right with God and we pray. And Jesus said to those religious in Matthew chapter 15, his disciples come to him and they said, Master, this teaching you've been teaching, you've really been teaching, you've been dealing with everybody's heart. Listen to what it says in Matthew 15:12. The Pharisees are offended with your sayings. They're offended with your teaching. Pharisees will get offended at the word of God.
Yeah.
They'll say, he's speaking about us. You're right, Lamb. Remember a few months ago I said, you can always tell when you throw a stone into a pack of dogs, the one that yelps is the one that got bit.
Yeah, that's right.
That night, within 5 hours, I got an email from someone who wasn't in the meeting. They yelped loud.
Yeah.
They wrote me an email, a terrible email saying, you shouldn't have preached what you preached this morning.
Mm.
You weren't there.
Yeah.
You weren't there. Yeah. You didn't even ask to hear the message. I would have sent you the message. You should have been here.
Mm-hmm.
But the dog yelped.
Amen.
You're not acting like a Christian. There's a way to act
yes.
like a Christian. But listen to what Jesus said. What do you do when people get offended? Brother Keith, don't you realize Jimmy and Johnny and Patrick and Mary, they're offended with things that you've taught?
Mm-hmm.
I think you should go and run after them. I think you should have a cup of tea. Take them out for a meal.
Mm.
Take them to the best restaurant in Limerick. I'd never stop. Don't have enough money, I'm afraid. What did Jesus say? Hey, they're offended. Listen to what he says, verse 14. Let them alone, they be blind leaders of the blind. Leave them alone.
Yeah.
If they're getting offended with the teaching of God's word, leave them alone. Every plant that hasn't been planted by my Father's going to be uprooted.
Mm-hmm.
Leave them alone.
Wow.
Oh, but we should go and minister them. No.
Yeah.
Stay away from them.
Yeah.
Aren't you glad that when Saul of Tarsus, the man who murdered Christians and destroyed churches, that when he first got saved, no Christian would go near him? They think he's a dog or they think he's a pig. But yet there was one Ananias who heard from God and the Lord said, go, he's a praying man. And a Barnabas who came and said, I'll bring you into the church. They're all scared of him. They're scared he's a dog. Aren't you glad that Saul of Tarsus wasn't treated as a dog? It took Barnabas to discern. He's a sheep. He's a sheep. And you know what? In the church I've seen people say, he's a wolf. No, he's a sheep. And said, he's a sheep. No, he's a wolf.
Yeah.
And if you don't know how to judge, if you have not learnt how to judge animal from animal, if you have not become someone who knows a sheep and a dog and a pig and a wolf, you're going to get very confused. You're going to think they're all sheep. What's going on?
Yeah.
They're not all sheep.
Amen.
No sheep attacks a shepherd.
That's right.
Especially one that's feeding them faithfully.
Yeah.
No, you're not giving pig food. You're going to have sheep food.
Yeah.
I want pig food. Then that's because you're a pig.
Yeah. Yeah. Amen.
Look at these lovely pearls. I don't think they're precious. That's because you are a pig.
Yes.
Since there are many in this city which are lost sheep. We're after them. Yes. We're going to go get the prodigals. Yes. We're going to get the demon possessed.
Yes.
We're going to get the worst sinners.
Amen.
We are going looking for them. We need discernment, saying, come into the kingdom of God. But those in the house of God who are acting like pigs and dogs and wolves, we don't want them, saints.
Yeah.
We don't want them. And when they walk off, don't you cry tears over them.
Yeah.
Don't you run after them. And I tell you, Judas, let me finish with this important scripture. As I finish, Judas the master manipulator. It's important to tell you this before I close. In John 13, 27, sitting at the Lord's table, the Last Supper, we actually read it after Judas put the bit of bread, dipped it at the table, Satan entered into Judas. Then said Jesus unto Judas, what did he say? Please don't betray me. Please, just one more time. Will you not think about this? He didn't. He said, see what you're going to do. Do quickly.
Yeah.
Didn't tell anyone else. Said, Judas, you made your decision to betray truth and righteousness and to betray your master. You made a decision and Satan himself has entered into you and you're determined. Do it quickly. Didn't try to talk him out of it. You know why? Because he preached all through those months and all through those years. And he said, you don't need to do this. You don't need to sin. But when it got to that point, Jesus went, you go do it.
Yeah.
And you know what? I'll see you in that garden and you'll give me a kiss. And that's going to seal your eternal fate in an eternal hell. Since you don't run after Judas when he leaves that table of the Lord.
Amen.
He's a dog. He's a pig. And if you try to run after him, he will rend you badly. Stand with me here this morning. Hallelujah. We pray.